Yeah, going live earlier today. Let's get it. Bit of tipperoonos for your Wednesday afternoon. Hey guys, how you going? Sit down, Bakehouse Sport. We are here a little bit earlier than usual. We're here at 3 p.m. on Wednesday. Well, actually, it's later because usually I put it on Tuesday. But because of the Easter Monday game between the Eels and Tigers, which was awesome, followed by putting the vlog out yesterday from the Titans versus Dolphins game. That has then pushed this stream to today. So it's late in that regards, but I usually do it about 4 p.m. Queensland time. But I do have to film the Gold Coast Titans Frontline podcast later on this afternoon with Clarky. So I'm jumping on here earlier. We'll see how long we crack on for. But we'll be going through every single game here today, guys, for round five. As you guys know, we do every single week. We're still in the positive. We're 20-12. I think I got five tips right last week. Which actually, let's quickly go through them, to be fair. If you guys are watching this live, great, appreciate you. Obviously, hit that thumbs up button and subscribe if you're new around here. If you're watching this after we have been live, there will be timestamps in the description or the timestamps on the screen here that you can click to the exact game that you obviously do want. So, yeah, we'll obviously be going through every single game, but you can see when we were speaking about the game that you were after. I got the Panthers game right, I got the Rabbitohs game right, and I got the Broncos game right there. So I was 3-0, and then Saturday, I come a gutsa. I did obviously went with Manly. And I did go with the Titans there, right? So that one's always going to be expected, though, yeah? So I got those two. So I was 3-2. Got the Warriors right. Got the Sharkies right. And then got the Eels game wrong. Even though I did tell you guys that I thought the Tigers would be very well up for it and it would be a close game, I did still lean with the Eels there. So I was 5-3. I'll still take it. I'm still in the positive. And we move on to this round here. Obviously, I am 20-12 of the season. So as long as I stay above 50%, I'll take it. I'm taking it to the absolute bank. But if you guys don't know how this works, when we go through every game, I'll read through the two-team lineups. I'll go through my analysis, my prediction, and then we'll have a brief little quick chat in the comment section. I won't be able to stay as long today. As I said, I have to do that podcast later on tonight, later on this afternoon. But we'll be back tomorrow anyway for the Storm vs. Broncos as they kick off our weekend on Thursday. But let's get into the chat. Let's see what you guys are saying. And let's crack on, baby. Hit that thumbs up button and subscribe. And I hope you guys enjoyed the vlog yesterday. I hope you guys enjoyed the vlog. K-Bitch says, pretty nervous for the Bronx game. Yeah, I see your messages by the... There's no sound. There is sound. What do you mean? What do you mean? There's no sound. Woo! Woo! Is there no sound? You still no sound, Jay? Jay, don't make me scream into that microphone, son. Don't make me scream into that microphone, son. Don't you make me do it, son. I'll do it. I will do it. But yeah, KB, I hope the Broncos lose for you because I see your comments about the Titans and the messages. I just don't reply to you. Parramatta Eels says, now there is. Well, there we go. There we go. Aguero says, has Dragons fans. Sucks to see Lomax go, but at least it leaves us with an extra 800K. Yeah, you've got to see the positives in that, man. And it's just like, obviously, he just doesn't want to be there, right? Oh, obviously, I wasn't the Muppet that said that. Oh, you... Oh, Jay. Oh, I thought you were the one who said it. Hey, I am the Muppet. Don't worry. I'm the Muppet, Jay. Don't worry. That's me. I take full responsibility. I do take full responsibility for that one. I, for some reason, my brain thought that you were saying there wasn't sound. But anyway, we move. But yeah, obviously Lomax doesn't want to be there at the Dragons, man. So you just got to move on to a guy that obviously does want to be there. I could have told you this about Zach a while ago, to be fair. Beast of Lads, of course, Power Fan says that. Adam Smart says the sound. And yeah, great start, Jack. Great start. Thank you, mate. Thank you very much. Cryptic says Storm win. Great record at Suncourt. Money Hughes and Welsh back. Your opinion doesn't really count because you are a Storm fan. So of course you're going to say that. But yeah, look, obviously, let's get into these games here today, guys, because like I said, it'll probably go for about an hour to an hour and 10 today. I usually go for about an hour and a half, but I want to crack on with it, give you my predictions, and I will be in Townsville from Friday, so I'll be streaming live on Friday night and Saturday night up there in Townsville for you guys, as I will be there for the Titans vs. Cowboys game on Sunday. But alrighty, guys, like I said, hit that thumbs up button, subscribe if you're new around here. First game, obviously, chat away in the comment section. Let me know your thoughts. Tell me your thoughts about each individual game. Obviously, try and keep it about the game we're talking about. We will get on to every game where you can chat about that one, all right? But the first one is the Melbourne Storm taking on the Brisbane Broncos. Now, this is, I know I said this is round five. Well, of course, this is round five. At Amy Park in Melbourne, it is fifth place Storm taking on the 12th place Broncos, whilst the Storm are $1.44 and the Broncos are $2.79. Now, The beauty for the Storm is they're coming off a bye. They're fresh, maybe. They are fresh sun. They are ready to rock and roll here. They've had a great season so far, man, where, you know, you go at the go and have a look at the games that they have played. We'll quickly just go have a look here at the Storm's draw so far. So they beat the Panthers 8-0. They beat the Warriors in that really miraculous game with that Xavier Coates try 30-26. They did lose to the Knights. However, they didn't have a few of their guys. You know, they didn't have... I don't think Jerome... Well, no, it was Jerome... Jerome Hughes wasn't playing. He was suspended. There was no Cameron Munster. And they were just a little bit all over the shop. They had their halves completely out of it. So you kind of give them excuses for this. And they still only lost by the 2 points. And there's also... There was no Nelson or Salamona. There was just a few of that. Christian Welsh was out. So, yeah, look, it was a really harsh one to take there for the Melbourne Storm fans to only lose by two. But with that being said, there was the positives there. Now, and that was in Newcastle as well, which it just didn't look great for them. Now, the Brisbane Broncos, on the other hand, obviously, they come into this game after getting a surprise win against the Cows. I did predict it. I did say the Broncos would be too good for that one at Suncorp Stadium. The Cowboys just didn't look great, and Adam Reynolds was just absolutely fantastic in that game, man. Like, you cannot say that Reno was not absolutely unbelievable with his kicking game. It was really good to watch, and yeah, the Broncos maybe have gotten back into a bit of a rhythm. They obviously needed Reno there. You go back and have a quick little look-see at their draw themselves. It hasn't been a great season so far, really. You know, they did beat the Rabbitohs at 28-18, but the Rabbitohs have their own problems at the moment. They are still in crisis mode. They lost to the Roosters 20-10, and they got thumped by the Panthers there 34-12, which had excuses. But with that being said, got thumped 34-12 there and just never looked likely. So, you know, the Broncos are a bit up and down. And now they're looking to kind of get a bit of rhythm and consistency about the season. But they do suck in Melbourne, and they do suck against Melbourne normally. Now, I know the Broncos did knock out but they beat the Storm last season in the first week of the finals after getting beaten by them in the last week of the regular season. But both teams didn't play pretty much anybody of their starting teams because it was just that rest week, effectively. So the Broncos are coming in off a win against the Storm. However, they've won one out of their last 10, I believe. One out of their last 10 games against the Melbourne Storm, and that was that game. So they do not have a great record against them. But let's get into the two-team lineup. So Aaron Penne, Cameron Munster, Christian Welch, Jack Howarth, Jerome Hughes, and Marion Seve are all in. So some massive ins there for the Storm. And then you go to the outs, which is Grant Anderson and Kane Bradley. The fullback, or Little Muddlin, Bobby Pappenhausen. With the wingers being Will Warbrick and Xavier Coates. Centres of Remus Smith and Nick Meaney. You go to the 5'8", Cameron Munster with the halfback of Jerome Hughes. So good to see their halves back in action, especially Munster, who this will be his first game this season. You go to the front rowers, Tui Kamikamitha and Josh King, with Harry Grant, the captain, in number 9. You go to the back row, Sean Blore and Elias Ekotoa, with Trent Oliero as the lock. Interchange, Tyron Wishart, Christian Welch, Tepe Moroa, and Alec McDonald, with the reserves being Chris Lewis, Jack Howarth, Marion Seve, Jonah Pezzett, and Aaron Penne. So this Storm team, no excuses now. They've got their full team ready to rock and roll. Obviously, still no Nelson, but apparently Nelson is on the outer at Melbourne as well due to professionalism, is what they're saying. I know a lot of clubs will want to come in for him, to be fair, so... This Storm team overall is what you would expect them to put out, and they don't have an excuse to lose it, in my personal opinion, especially back at home in Melbourne after a bye and just having a pretty good season so far, a really good season so far, to be fair. Moving to the Broncos, Blake Moser, Deloise Hoiter, Jock Madden, Jordan Pereira, and Martin Tapau will be in, with Xavier Willison being out. Fullback, Tristan Saylor, with the wingers being Jesse Arthurs and Dean Mariner. Centers are Tony Staggs and Selwyn Cobbo. Go to the 5'8", Ezra Mann, with Adam Reynolds as the halfback. He is captain. Front rowers are Corey Jensen and Fletcher Baker, with the number 9 being Billy Walters. Back row, Jaden Hunt and Jordan Ricky Dog. Jordan Ricky, with Patrick Carrigan as the lock. Interchange, Tyson Smoothie, Benjamin Takura, Kobe Hetherington and Corey Oates, with the reserves being Martin Tapau, Jock Madden, Delois Hoiter, Jordan Pereira, and Blake Moser. This Broncos team, who are they missing? They're missing Payne Huss for sure, obviously. Xavier Willison was having a pretty good season, but I think he copped a head knock in training, if I'm not mistaken. Could be wrong there. Obviously missing Reece Walsh, but you obviously got to look at these two halves here, and Ezra Mann and Adam Reynolds, to really understand that they should be still getting the job done. You know, they still should be getting a good motor going, and Tristan Saylor is pretty much the same player as Reece Walsh, which is what I said last week and was why I favoured the Bronx, was because they don't lose a great deal from Reece Walsh to Saylor, in my personal opinion. I do think Reece Walsh is obviously that more defined product right now, But I do think Tristan Taylor is very similar. So it's not like they're changing their game plan around a completely different styled fullback. They're very, very similar there. And outside of that, besides the loss of Payne Haas, you know, this Broncos team isn't really missing a great deal. So they should be well and truly up for this one. But I will take the Storm. I will take the Storm at home in Melbourne. I think that I have to. You know, I was convinced the Broncos would get it. If this was at Suncorp, I think it would be a super close game. The Broncos could be well and truly in and could grab. And I do think that the Storm have started off the season with a bit of false hope that they are this, you know, undeniable team throughout the rest of the season where they will just continuously stay up that top. I do know what the Storm are like, obviously. We've grown up with this game that we always expect the Storm to fall off and they don't. But it's just like you look outside of their spine, which is finally fully healthy, and it's not exactly wild, especially in that front row, the front row there, especially in the forwards. And it's not exactly something crazy exciting, but they get the job done. They just get the job done there. Guys like Josh King, doesn't light the world on fire, gets the job done. Tui Kamehameha, doesn't light the world on fire, gets the job done. Trent Liero, another one there. We've got a Trent Liero fan club in this chat half the time, right? So although their forwards don't excite me, at the end of the day, their spine's just going to drag them along. And I think they should win this game here in Melbourne. So I will take the Melbourne Storm and I will take them by... I might take it by eight points. Yeah, I just think that they'll be able to get this one. I do think that they will cop a couple of losses, you know, upcoming. But I think that right now they should be too good in this game. All right. Cookie says, no Hughes, no Money, no Nelson, no Welsh, no Chan. Let's settle down on the old no Chan. Like, I can understand the Welsh and Nelson and Money and Hughes, but let's settle down on the Chan. You wouldn't even know who Joe Chan was before this season started. Would have seen his name, would have had no idea about him. So let's settle down on the no Chan. Nelson, Money, Hughes and Welsh is definitely something against the Knights that we do cater to. Dasher says Storm won the second half against the Knights. Yeah, crazy, man. Crazy. Justin Simon says Storm win. I agree. Luke says Storm 13 plus, fresh off a bye, and also getting Munster and Hughes' scary hours for the league. Yeah, and look, they have impressed. Although I say that I think the Storm will start to falter a little bit with their lack of outside of the spine, I do think that, you know, they have been so good even without Munster, man. They have been so good even without some of their players. And, you know, maybe that just proves again that we're all just wrong again about the Storm. They just will keep on going. They will keep on going. It's just how the Storm go. It's Craig Bellamy, man. He just knows how to get his players up and at him. He just knows it. Aiden Brace, I got Storm by 10. Dasher says Melbourne by 10. Aguero says, congratulations on 26K, Mr. Streamer. Been here since 2018. Good to see you getting bigger and bigger. 2018, gee whiz, yeah, well, that's 6 years ago now, man. Yeah, good on you. I appreciate you for tuning in all that time. And our statistics says Storm 26-16 to the Broncos. Yeah, I could see something similar. I'll probably go like a 24-16, I guess, because I went by 8. So I'll go 24-16. Luke says Storm 36, Broncos 16. Wow, you got a big Storm win there. And Cavi Bars says Broncos 22-12, Storm 10-point win from Bronx. And I'm saying Arthur's first try scorer. Yeah, look, is there a world the Broncos win? Yes, I just don't see it likely. After a bye, this Storm team fresh, they're at home, so they've been able to stay at home without any travel. I don't know, man. I think it's been really, really hot and humid in Queensland, and in Melbourne, it's just not hot and humid. You know what I'm saying? So maybe it gets a little bit cooler for the Broncos. I'm looking forward to getting out of Canberra next week for this very reason. It is humid right now where I am, right? So... Melbourne's not exactly that kind of weather. So I give the Melbourne Storm the advantage there, but obviously weather doesn't really impact it. If it was raining, Broncos looked really good in the rain. They looked really good in the rain on the weekend. Really good in the rain. But all right, I'll take the Storm 1-12 in that game. All right, we move now into Friday action. Guys, obviously smack that thumbs up button. Subscribe if you're new around here. The Canterbury Bulldogs take on the Sydney Roosters. The Bulldogs, 14th position, with the Roosters being in 7th position. The Bulldogs come into this game as underdogs of $3.78, while the Roosters are $1.27, and it is at a core stadium in Sydney. Now, the Bulldogs, they come in to this game after doing kind of what I said, but doing better than what I said. But then again, they played the Rabbitohs, right? So what I said was that the Titans versus the Dragons whooped the Titans, and then they came back to earth the week later against the Dolphins, lost 38-0. And then the Titans played the Dogs, and the Dogs whooped the Titans 32-0, and I said they'll come back down to earth the next week against the Rabbitohs. And I said it will be, regardless of the score, and I thought the Rabbitohs would win 13+, to be fair, but regardless of the score, the Rabbitohs had not won a game this season. They were in crisis mode. They had no idea what they were doing with their team. And if the Bulldogs were just to lose, it's not, if they were to win, it wouldn't prove a great deal about them, but if they were to lose, it would show that they still are kind of really struggling to get moving. And it was more the Titans than anybody else, right, than themselves. And that's kind of what it did prove in that game. You know, they are still looking to take that next step. They are still looking. And I genuinely believe they just need to look their spine and really need to focus on their spine personally. Because the Bulldogs, they're a team that is so desperate to move out of that bottom area right now, and it just isn't clicking. It just is not clicking. And this game isn't the one for it to click in, because they're going up against the Sydney Roosters, who are coming off a pretty heart-wrenching loss there to the Panthers, where I know the scoreline favoured them. It looked okay for them. I think they only lost by 6 points, if I'm not wrong, in the end. What was it? Yeah, 22-16. So I did predict the Panthers to win that, even though the Roosters were pretty solid favourites with no Nathan Cleary for the Panthers. But the Roosters just did not get it going. They just did not get it going. So this is a harsh game for the Bulldogs to come back up against them, when the Roosters obviously believe really high, lofty expectations this year. I always say, under-deliver on over-expectations is the Sydney Roosters. And that's what I believe they will do this year. But this game is a big bounce-back potential game for them. And I'd be nervous if I was a Doggies fan. Even though Dogs fans have high expectations themselves, which is a little bit unrealistic, the Roosters are going to come in here with a bit of a vengeance after what we saw against the Panthers, in my personal opinion. Now, the Bulldogs, their team lineup: Bailey Haywood, Bronson Cherry, Chris Patolo, Harrison Edwards, Kitiona Kaltunga, Puasa Famausuli, and Toby Sexton are in, with Jacob Preston, Josh Hodokar, and Curtis Marin out. So two big outs there. Yeah, actually, I'd argue three. Curtis Marin was good on the weekend, but Preston and Hodokar obviously massive. Now, the fullback, Blake Taff, with the wingers being Blake Wilson and Connor Tracy. The centres of Jacob Kitteraz and Stephen Crichton, who is captain. 5'8", Matty Burton, with the halfback being Drew Hutchison. You go to the front row, Maxi King, my boy, and Samuel Hughes, with the number 9 being Reed Marnie. Back row, Viliami Kikau and Josh Curran, with the 13 being Jamin Salmon. At least we're seeing Josh Curran getting a start. Even though there's a little bit of a grab, he's a good player. So he's into the game there, into the starting 13. You go on to the interchange, Kurt Mann, Harrison Edwards, Liam Knight, and Kitiona Kaltunga, with the reserves being Bronson Cherry, Toby Sexton, Bailey Haywood, Chris Patolo, and Puasa Famausuli. Why is Hutchison still on the team is my personal opinion. You know, with all due respect to Hutchison, who is a much better player than I am, I don't understand how he's still in the 7. I don't think Toby lit the world on fire when he played for the Doggies last season, but I will say that Drew Hutchison, despite winning 32-0 over the Gold Coast, was not good in that game. And that was their only win of the season so far. I don't think he's had a good game for the Dogs. And I think that they need to look elsewhere. I still don't think Matt Burton is a 5'8". I still don't think he's in the halves. I think that their forwards will do a lot better with Curran in the starting lineup here. And Sammy Hughes obviously comes in as well. You know, this Dogs team still leaves a lot to be desired. A lot to be desired, man. At least Liam Knight's been doing better than his pre-season. Oh, I just think I clicked on his profile. No, I didn't. Don't worry about that. There's a lot to be desired here with the Dogs, and I still think that... And I saw a thing on Clarkie's page just before that Gus Gould is at odds and differences with what Cameron Serralda was thinking in regards to their 17. And I would agree if he was talking about the 7, for sure. And I would agree if he's talking about Matt Burton, for sure. I would consider... Like, if anything, like, you don't have a better 5'8 than Matt Burton, even though I don't believe he's a 5'8. Or do you just put Toby Sexton in a 5'8, which is what he actually counts through the grades, I believe, played a bit of 5'8 throughout his day, and might just have to take a step back to Hutcho in the direction. I don't know. You got to think of different options there. Do you put him in the centers and Crichton to the fullback, or do you put Matt Burton to the fullback and kick Crichton in the centers? I don't know. It's just thought processes, because I don't rate Blake Taff. I think that when you're looking across the 17 fullbacks in the game right now, Blake Taff would be down in that bottom 2, bottom 3 area. And you could make an argument for 17. But again, that's just my personal opinion. You go into the Roosters now and the Eels: Fetalaga, Pauga, Lindsay Collins, big in, Siwa Wong, and Zach Docker Clay with no outs. Fullback, captain James Tedesco, with the wingers being Daniel Tupo and Dom Young. Centers of Joseph Suwalii and... Joseph Manu, the 5'8 being Luke Keary, and the halfback being Sam Walker. Front row, Jadria Hargraves and Lindsay Collins, big in there. Brandon Smith is the 9, with Nat Butcher and Angus Crichton back row. Victor Radley is the lock. You go to the interchange, Connor Watson, Nafahu White, Satili Tupanua, and Terrell May, with the reserves being Michael Jennings, Egan Butcher, Fetalaga Pauga, Zach Docker Clay, and Siwa Wong. This Roosters team should not be losing this game. It just simply should not be. Let's go for a comparison. Tedesco to Taff. I'm taking Tedesco. Tupo and Dom Young to Wilson and Tracy. I've liked Connor Tracy this year, but I'm taking the Roosters there. Their centres, Joe Suwalii and Joseph Manu to Karaz and Crichton. I think that's probably the closest position the positions they have in the whole game. If there's a positional battle that I'm looking for the most, it is the centres of Karaz versus Suoli'i and Crichton versus Manu. That is a great battle. I still do lean towards that Roosters centre pairing. If Crichton was at the Panthers and Karaz was at the Panthers, I'd probably lean with them. But at the Dogs, you're only as good as your halves when you're a centre or a winger kind of deal. So I do still lean with Suoli'i and Manu. You go to the halves of Burton and Hutchinson and Walker and Keary. I'm taking Walker and Keary, not convincingly, but convincingly enough. Front rowers are Maxi King and Sam Hughes versus Warrior Hargraves and Lindsay Collins. I take the Roosters again. The nine, Brandon Smith, Reid Marnie. I take Brandon Smith. Back row, Nat Butcher and Crichton, Viliami Kikau and Curran. I think that's pretty close as well. I might actually lean with the Dogs there. 13, Radley, Salmon, easy Radley. And then you go to the bench, and I'm taking the Roosters bench every day of the week over the Dogs bench. So I'll take the Roosters in this game, and I'll take them 13 plus. I'll take the Roosters 13 plus in this game. I know that's just going to cause comments to say that I hate the Dogs, but it's like, I think you can understand where I'm coming from, to be fair. But I'll take the Roosters in this game. Gunner says, don't worry, Bicker. Titans will definitely win a game when they have to versus the Eels. Saw your comment. Cavi Bar says, Roosters win by 20 points instead of 10. Tedesco first try scorer. Definitely could see that. Yeah, I like that first try scorer a bit. Yeah, I like that. I don't mind that little prediction there, to be fair. Luke says, I think this game is all or nothing for Hutchinson, in my opinion. I think that him and Tanner are in very similar points where they need to go out and perform now, or they will be dropped very soon, if not next week, the week after. So I think, yeah, I think Hutchinson is in that boat. I think he definitely is in that boat. But then again, what do we know? You know, what do we know, you know? What do we know? Call Strike says Roosters 13 plus. Aiden Bray says Roosters by 20. Dasher says Roosters by 16, 30 to 14, quite an anytime try scorer. Bizzalaz says Roosters by 16. Luke, Bulldogs 1-12. Hopefully they get up for the occasion for the club's 20 years since winning the comp. Wishful thinking. I think that if it was any game but the Roosters here, man, I'd be a little bit more confident to back in and say, look, maybe the Doggies get up for it. But I do think that fans overrate this importance a lot more. And I do think that there are certain clubs that really get up for, say, milestone games, and they get up for historical representation compared to other clubs. You know, like, for example, the Titans, we lose every milestone game we have, pretty much, right? But some clubs, like the Roosters, will get up for the occasion, right? And I just don't know if the Bulldogs are going to be able to hand two straight losses to the Roosters. I just don't know if that's the case. And this is at a core stadium in Sydney, so it's like the Roosters know how to play there. It's not like they're afraid to play there, man. I just think the Roosters will be way too good in this game. If they were playing any other team, maybe, or not any other team, there's still a lot of teams I'd tip over them. But for their fans, for their sake, I hope they do better. I do. I hope they do better. Kobe Roblox says Doggies 1-12. That's crazy. Says, in my opinion, Roosters 28, Bulldogs 14. Taff and Tupou, many time try scorers. I don't know about Taff. I don't know about Taff scoring a try in this game. But then again, I'll probably be memed for saying that. You can't be a content creator and be scared of being wrong. Let's put it that way. But yeah, I don't think that Taff will score. I think the Roosters will win this game, well. I think they'll win this game, and they'll win this game well. And yeah, Sundo, no way Hutchinson has beaten us. I think Sundo will have a mental breakdown in our live stream on Friday. Are you going to the game, actually, Sundo? No, he probably won't. But he'll probably come in late on in the game and have a mental breakdown in the comment section, Sundo will, if they are losing and going to lose to Drew Hutchinson. I think he will. We know Sundo well. He doesn't like Sundo. He's Hutchinson's biggest fan. So... I think if the Roosters are losing, he'll pop into the stream and say, hey, listen, I don't know if I can do this anymore. I think he'll have a full-blown meltdown in the chat. I don't want to think about that. Exactly right, Zunder. Exactly right. I think he'll have a full-blown mental breakdown in the chat, but we love him. But I'm taking the Roosters 13+. I take Roosters 13+ in that one. All right, we move to the big game on Friday night. Whose idea was this, NRL? Whose idea was this one? We've got the Newcastle Knights taking on the St. George Illawarra Dragons, 15th versus 13th. Yippee! Woo! Woo! Hit that thumbs up button. Subscribe if you're new around here. That's the only way you're going to be able to get us through this game on Friday night. Do I have to stream this game on Friday night? I'll be in Townsville. Can I just stream the other game? Can I not stream this game? Do one of you guys want to stream this game for me on the channel? I don't know. But this will be a real interesting one to watch for all the wrong reasons. The Knights come to this game at McDonald's Jones Stadium. At $1.39 favourites, while the Dragons come in at $3 underdogs. I would love to know the ideology of the Knights being such heavy favourites in this game. I would love to know what the thought process is. because it should be like $1.90 a piece kind of deal, and not for the right reasons again. You know, let's go quickly back and have a look at the Knight season so far. It has not been pretty. It has not been pretty. They lost by a big margin to the Raiders in a game they were pretty heavy favourites for, 28-12. They lost to the Cowboys in the game they probably should have won. But they were both so bad, and they were just the worst. They beat Storm, but not really. They had a better game against the Warriors and still lost 20-12, and now they come up against the Dragons here. So, you know, it's not been a great season there for the Knights whatsoever. At least they're back home here. And the Dragons, they had a bye in round one, then they beat the they lost to the Dolphins 38-0. Then in round three, they got whooped by the Cowboys, and then they beat Manly in a surprise one. So they've been having a really up and down season outside of that bye here in round one. They've been having a really up and down season, man. So you don't really know what to kind of expect from them. So I'm just going to get out of that area and go back here. You don't really know what to expect there from the Dragons whatsoever. And that's why I'm surprised they're $3 underdogs whilst the Knights are favourites. I guess it's because they're at home. If this was in the Gong or this was at Cogra, you probably would see the Dragons being favourites for this game. But obviously it is in Newcastle. So yeah, I will really find this one a tough one to predict. But I do have a tip on the basis of some ins and outs. Now the Knights here, Dan Gagai, Jackson Hastings, Leo Thompson and Thomas Kent are in with nobody being out. Callum Ponga, fullback and captain, with the wingers being Thomas Jenkins and Inara Tuala. Centers of Dan Gagai and Brabham Best. Now, finally, something that I have literally been saying. If you guys watch my streams, you watch my content, you know I've been calling for Jack Cogger 5'8 and Jackson Hastings halfback for the whole season. Just like you guys have. I'm not saying that I'm the only one who's been calling it, but it's like finally we're seeing Jack Cogger and Hastings in the halves. Gamble is not in the 5'8. And I'm not doing this to throw shade at Gamble. That's not my purpose at all. I just believe that this is the best halves pairing that they have. Cogger is going to do a great job behind Hastings, who is the game decisive playmaker. So I like this change. You go to the front row, Jacob Saifidi and Leo Thompson, good in there, with Jaden Brayley as the number 9, so Crossan has lost his spot. You got Tyson Frizzell and Kai Pierce-Paul back row, and Adam Elliott is the lock. Interchange of Phoenix Crossland, Daniel Saifidi, Jack Hetherington, and Matt Croker, with the reserves being Dylan Lucas, Jed Cartwright, Brody Jones, Tyson Gamble, and Thomas Cairns. This is the team I wanted to see. I still worry about Phoenix Crossland. I still don't think he is as good as what we saw from the back end of last season. I did have this concern preseason, as you guys know. But outside of that, this team should really be doing... Like, the wingers are the concern. They've got no Greg Martyu. They lost Dom Young to the Roosters. Their wingers, their cherry on tops, are a concern in regards to putting that ball down over the line as the cherry on top. Their centers, great. Fullback, great. Halves, like it. Front rowers, like it. Nine, still left wanting. Back row, like it. 13, don't mind it. Interchange, don't mind it. Don't mind it. So this Knights team is not as bad as their record suggests. But again, that'll tell us a lot about them, who they are this week against the Dragons, is what I'll say. This week will tell us a lot about who this Newcastle Knights team is. Because this should be, in their mind, they should be thinking they're going to beat this team. They should be going into this game with the confidence that we're going to win. Not that we have already won, the confidence that we have a good opportunity to beat this team and we're going to beat this team. Right? This Knights team and your fan base should be going to this game expecting a win here. And that's, I guess, why the favouritism is there of $1.39. I just don't think that's warranted based off of the season so far for both these teams. Dragons, on the other hand, Ben Murdoch-Masila, Christian Tuipulotu, Toby Couchman, and Viliami Fifita are in, with nobody being out. The fullback is Tyrell Sloan, with the wingers being but about the squeals man, tax man, Zach Lomax, and Michele Revalawa, with the centers being Moses Suli and Jack Bird. 5'8", Kyle Flanagan, halfback Ben Hunt, who is captain, with the front row of Francis Molo and Jack DeBellin. Number 9, Jacob Little. You go to the back row, Luciano Leilua and Jaden Sewer, with the 13 being Tom Eisenhuth. Interchange-wise, Jesse Marschke, Blake Laurie, Michael Molo, and Raymond Fatala-Marina, with the reserves being Hame Sele, Christian Tuipulotu, Viliami Fifita, Toby Couchman, and Ben Murdoch-Masila. The Dragons team just does not get it going for you, and I think that they beat this Manly team off the back of Manly being just awful on the weekend, to be fair. This Dragons team will win games you do not expect, and they will lose games that you do not expect or do expect, whatever. This Dragons team is going to be so hot and cold, hot and cold, hot and cold. But I do think they'll obviously be more cold than hot. And I think that going into this game, I do think the Knights will win. I will tip the Knights. And I will tip them... I'll tip them 1-12, but I could see a world they win 13+. I really like that halves pairing for them. I do like the halves pairing of Jack Cogger and Jackson Hastings for them. And I think that'll get them going a lot more. They do bring in Jaden Brayley into that nine. Fingers crossed and was the guy, but Brayley was injured. They were going to bring Brayley, I believe, into that nine regardless. Once he was fully fit and healthy, and now he is in Kalimpong in that one. I do like this team much better. And I just think that the Dragons, they've got so many players who don't want to be there. Lomax doesn't want to be there. It's obvious. Ben Hunt doesn't want to be there. Dragons fans, you cannot tell me Ben Hunt wants to be there. You just cannot tell me. You know, Lomax was telling you 2-3 weeks ago that he likes playing for the Dragons. Does he like playing for the Dragons? Is that why he's put in a request to leave? Is that why there's a potential that he could actually leave this season, not just next season, but this season? You know, like, the Dragons need to understand that they need to have players who want to play for them. They need to have players who want to play for them. And I just don't think that these two guys... you can only do what you can do, right? I'm not saying that you have to just throw everybody out there. But I just can't be confident in a team that doesn't even have players and their captain who does not want to be there. So I will take the Knights here. I will take the Knights. I can see a world 13+. I will take 1-12. And that 13+ isn't necessarily reflective of the Knights. It's a mixed reflection of both these teams. But also, is there a world the Dragons win? Yeah, for sure. There is a world. There is a world. I'm not convinced in that world, but there is a world. But I'll take Knights. I'll take Knights. Sam's having an argument with the Muppet of the chat. Luke says, hardest game to tip this round, but letting Dragons 1-12 based on current form. Never go current form the Dragons. Metalheads says, agreed. Dragons are going to surprise, Metalhead Monarch says. Well, I don't think it's a surprise. I don't think the Dragons win this game would be a surprise based on form. I wouldn't say that. Aiden Brace says, nice by 10. I'll stream this game if you want. I'll somehow make it interesting. Thanks, man. I was joking, but thanks, man. Now, Cowboys going to show why they're second in charge of the Queensland section. Cool story. Bah. Aguero says, Knights 20, Dragons 24. You're a Dragons fan. Did you see Hastings have a go at Vossi? Yeah, it's quite funny, right? Because I said the same thing on stream. So Hastings had a go at Vossi because he was saying that Jackson Hastings is sleeping on the hill. Now, I said the same thing on stream. Right, and I'll put my hand up and say, if I was wrong, I was wrong. But it did look like him, man. It did look like Hastings on the hill. I wouldn't be surprised if he was on the hill. But like at the end of the day, I'm not going to go out and you know, deny what he said, right? Because he knows about where he was rather than me. But it did look like he was on the hill sleeping. And I called the same thing. I said, how invested is he in this club right now? I don't think so much. You know, again, I'll put my hand up and say that. I made a mistake if that's the case. But I don't think that Vossi was necessarily... Well, I think Vossi is on a much larger public level, so I can understand why Jackson would have called it out. But I also do know that Jackson watches this content on my channel from time to time too. So I hope he doesn't have a crack at me in my DMs. Nah, he was nice. He's nice to me when he conversates with me. Shirat says, feel bad for Ben. It's part of the game. Signed a contract. Cavi Blast, it's nice. Went by 6 points, 12-6. First try scorer, Bama Best, Dan Gagai, anytime try scorer. That's Crazy says, is this a good move? I'd say Lomax should sign with Broncos or Eels. Broncos is the most random conversational point ever. Also, don't think they're going to spend that much on the cap on a center when they've already got two guys they're pretty okay with. I think there is a few teams on the market that it could make sense, but I know one team that he won't go to, and that's because of... Oh, no. No, I don't think he'll be coming to the Titans, that's for sure. He's not mature enough to move past shit like that, bro. But I'll take the Knights in this game, and I'll take them 1-12, but I could see a world where either team wins, and I could see a world with the Knights win 13+, but I will go Knights 1-12. All right, we move to Saturday now. We've got the South Sydney Rabbitohs taking on the New Zealand Warriors. Rabbitohs in 16th position, while the New Zealand Warriors are in 10th position. Obviously, guys, smack that thumbs up button. Subscribe if you're new around here. We're at a Core Stadium in Sydney. For the early game, I will be streaming this game up there in Townsville. The Rabbitohs, $2.04 underdogs, whilst the Warriors are $1.81. Interesting odds there, man. Very interesting odds that the Rabbitohs are as close to the Warriors as they are considering their form. You go back over the form of the Rabbitohs so far. Obviously, they're coming in after that win against the Doggies, and they're happy with that, but also still very concerned that it was only 2016, and It's still very concerned, is what I'll say there after that game. Before that, they lost 48-6 to the Roosters, 28-18 to the Broncos, and 36-24 to the Manly Seagulls. So, yeah, really concerning season so far with the Rabbitohs. They still are just all over the shop. They don't know what they want to do yet. Is Latrell going to centre? Do you have a better fullback? Are you going to stay with Hawkins? Are you going to go back to Ilias? Like, obviously, the spine's not really working. You've still got injuries in Campbell Graham and Tyrone Munro. Do you bring Tyrone Munro straight back? Campbell Graham's still out for a few months. The forwards just aren't really doing much. So there's a lot of issues at the Rabbitohs right now, and they're coming up against a team that is starting to click. I would say the Warriors are starting to click here. They beat the Knights on the weekend 20-12 at Auckland, which wasn't that impressive. And they also did beat the Raiders as well at Christchurch, which also wasn't that impressive. But the most impressive game of their season so far for me has been the one that they lost here to the Melbourne Storm. They lost 30-26 at Amy Park in Melbourne, and obviously it was just a freak play that they lost to right at the end of the game. I thought that was their best performance of the season, and they lost it. And obviously lost to the Sharkies after dominating them for 20 minutes, and the Sharks came over the top of them. So, for me, the Warriors are a really hard team to pick right now because the two wins that they've had, I haven't been crazily impressed with. But the loss against the Melbourne Storm was probably the one that I was most impressed with. So, yeah, really interesting. And this is in Sydney, so they've had two home games, and now they're travelling away. Now, for the Rabbitohs, their team, lineup ins. Isaac Tuitupo, Thompson, Jacob Gagai, Jai Gray, Peter Mamouzelis, Richard Kenner, and Sean Kepi are in, with Alex Johnston and Shekhar Mitchell being out. You've got the fullback, Latrell Mitchell, with the wingers being Isaac Thompson and Tane Milne. Really confused why no Jacob Gagai still. And Jack Whiten and Isaiah Taz are the centres. You've got Cody Walker as the 5'8", and Dean Hawkins as the halfback, with Tevita Tatola and Thomas Burgess front row. Damian Cook is the hooker. You've got the back row, Keon Kalamatangi, and Jacob Host, interesting still, with Cameron Murray as the lock, who is captain. Interchange, Michael Cheekham, Talis Duncan, Sean Kepi, and David Mawali, with the reserves being Peter Mamouzelis, Lachlan Elias, Richard Kenner, Jai Gray, and Jacob Gagai. Don't know why Jacob Gagai is not in the team over Thompson, especially considering he had such a good game in week one against the Manly Seagulls. I don't even know why Tane Milne is still there over Jacob Gagai, to be fair. Maybe a bit of experience, but also just, at least he takes tough runs back, I guess. That's all I can see. Still concerned with Trell, obviously, but we'll see how he does get on there. Halves are still a concern. Front row is still a concern, but did a decent enough job against the Dogs, but it's the Dogs. Still need to see more from Cookie. Keon Kalamatangi, fine, but not getting a great deal compared to what we've seen. Host, I still think Talis Duncan should start. And Murray, obviously, he's just a workhorse, man. Murray is fantastic. Any team would be lucky to have him. So this Rabbitohs team, a lot of concerns, a lot of question marks, a lot of worries. But they've got some good star talent like Latrell, like Jackie Whiten, like Cody Walker, like Damo Cook, Kalamatangi, Murray, these kind of guys, right? So they do have the star talent. Interested to see what Sean Kepi does off the bench, because he's not had a good season for the Rabbitohs so far. Now, going to the Warriors, Ali Liotewa, Chance, Nickel, Kokstad big in there. Edward Kosi, Jacob Laban, Tamari Martin, and Tom Ali are in, with Kurt Catewell and Luke Metcalf out. Two massive outs there for the Wires. We go to the fullback, Chance, Nickel, Kokstad. First game of the season, looking forward to saying that. The Warriors have a plethora of fullbacks right now. They've got Tane Tuopiki, they've got Chance, Nickel, Kokstad, and Roger Tuivasa-Sheck, who did a great job there on the weekend. But Chance comes back in, and this just really completes a lot of their back line, to be fair. It just sucks that we've seen that Luke Metcalf is now out because he was having such a good season at 5'8". So Chance on Crocside fullback, with Daniel Martinez, Lesniak, and Marcelo Montoya on the wings, with Rocco Berry fan club, baby, in the number three, alongside Roger Tuivasa-Sheck. Go to the 5'8", to Muddy Martin, with the halfback being Sean Johnson. The front row of Adam Fanua-Blake and Mitchell Barnett, with the number nine being Wade Egan. That's good to keep him in there because he's been kind of nearly getting injured. Well, he has been injured for a little bit, and also was, I think there was a threat of an injury on the weekend. I'm not sure. I think it was maybe elbow, but he's playing, so that's good. A back row, Jackson Ford and Murata Niokore, with Toru Harris as the lock. Interchange-wise, Freddie Lussick, Tom Ali, Bunty Afua, and Jazz Tavanga. With the reserves being Adam Pompey, Jacob Laban, Chanel Harris-Taveda, Edward Kosi, and Ali Liotewa. This Warriors team, I really like it. I do. I really like it. Even Tamati Martin coming in, he knows how to do a job. I do think Luke Metcalf is a big loss there because they were doing really well with Luke Metcalf, and he was starting to really come into his own as a player. I love their 1-3-5, and that's including Montoya, even though defensively he can be a little bit inept at times, but he's a hard hitter, man. He's a hard hitter. And their forwards, I think it's a good mix of X-factor, but also real just solid solidity. You know what I'm saying? Like, Adam Fanua-Blake has that X-factor and solidity, to be fair. And then you've got Jackson Ford, who is just straight up solid. Mitchell Barnett, straight up solid. Neil Cordray can have a bit of X factor about him, and Tall Harris has a bit of a mixture as well. So I'm going to take the Warriors in this game. I'm going to take them 1-12. I could see a Wallow win 13+, but I will take the Warriors in this game. I do think they deserve to be favourites. I could see a Wallow win 13+. I could. I think the Rabbitohs are not out of the woods yet. I know they've got that win, but they're not out of the woods yet. And I think this Warriors team, they proved that they can outgrind the Grinders in Canberra the other week. And the Knights are also a bit of a grindy team at times as well. And they've just been able to do that against the grindy teams. I think the Warriors are looking solid enough right now. And I think the Rabbitohs, could I see them winning for sure? But I think that the Warriors are at a better moment right now than what I think the Rabbitohs will be later on in the year. I think the Rabbitohs will come home strong. But I think the Warriors will get this win in this game here this week. So I'll go 1-12. Is the 13+ a likely? Maybe not likely, but it's a decent enough chance. Sunday says Waz winning. Yeah, of course you'd say that, Roosters fan. Sam Jenkins said I wouldn't say city base. Wait, what? In regards to Taxman. True. No, he's asking about who Sam's team is. Oh, true. Yeah, no, Sam is a massive Brisbane Broncos fan. Jordan says Warriors always fall off last 20 minutes and leak points. I don't know if that's how the game went on the other day, was it? I don't think that was how the Warriors game happened the other day, did it? No, they scored in the 73rd minute. That's the Knights. You might be right, actually. You might be right. Well, they didn't give up many points in the last 20 minutes to the Sharks. And then, I'm going to go back through their season quickly here. Warriors. The Storm game, yes. Raiders game, not so much, really. Knights game, one try. And the Sharks game was no tries in the last 20 minutes. Actually, let's go and have a look here for you. So, no tries in the last 20 minutes there for the Sharks. For the Storm, two tries in the last 3 minutes. So, I'll give you that one. I'll say yes, but it's still only 3 minutes, not 20. The Raiders game, no tries in the last 20 minutes for the Raiders. And the Knights game, one try in the last 7 minutes. So, I'm not going to give you the Knights, but I'll give you the Storm game, yes. But I kind of disagree with you. I kind of disagree with you in that regards. I don't think the Warriors falter there. I think that they've been a pretty good grindy team, actually. I would disagree with that notion. Warriors 22-18, Rabbitohs. I like that. That's a good little scoreline there. That's a good little scoreline. I'm going to Canberra in the next month, though. Sam will be in Canberra next week. James Stevens says, Wazzers need a good road record if they want to go all the way. I agree. I agree. Basically, says Warriors by 8. Okay, guys in the chat, let's stop talking about this. Let's stop spamming the chat with who Sam supports. With all due respect to my boy Sam, he's a Titans fan. We don't care. So, let's get back to the conversation about the game, please, because it's just way too much spam and I'm missing out on comments that are actually relatable to the game. Kavish says Waz by 1-12. Bizzalab Warriors by 8. And there you go. I can't see if there's any. Aiden Brace is South by 6. Yeah, guys, let's try and re-get this chat back to the game, because with all due respect, we don't care. And you know I love you, Sam. You know I love you. But I'll take the Waz, and I'll take them 1-12. Dasha says, as a Bunnies fan, I honestly don't really know who to pick. I would back my team, but it looks like the odds are against the Bunnies. Yeah. Yeah, I guess in a 50-50-ish game, I would still say you should get behind your team. And I still would say get behind your team regardless, right? But yeah, you should have belief that the Rabbitohs can win this game, because they definitely can win this game, mate, is what I'll say. They definitely can. But I'm going to lean with the Warriors as a non-biased spectator in this game. So I'll take Warriors 1-12, could see World 13+. I'll take them 1-12. All right, now let's move into the next game, which is the Manly Seagulls versus the Penrith Panthers. Obviously, guys, hit that thumbs up button, subscribe if you're new around here. This is the midday game on Saturday, and gee whiz, this is going to be a weird one to kind of predict. Manly come to this game in 11th position, whilst the Panthers come in 2nd position. Manly at Four Pines Park, which is Brookvale, $2.34 underdogs, whilst the Panthers are $1.61 favourites. And Manly coming in off a really disappointing loss. A really, really disappointing loss to the Dragons. No one expected it. Manly have looked so good so far this season. Maybe they started to believe their own hype. I don't know. But, you know, they lost the Eels in controversial fashion. Maybe they thought that they deserved that and it was still impacting them. I don't know. Beat the Roosters really nicely and beat the Rabbitohs. And then, yeah, just kind of fell off these last two games. So, I'm not too sure what to think of Manly right now. They've really kind of thrown a bit of a spanner in the works in regards to what we should think of them. And on the other side of the equation, you've got the Panthers who won 8-0 against the Storm, lost 8-0 against the Storm, and then beat the Eels 26-18, beat the Broncos 34-12, and then clearly-less beat the Roosters 22-16. So that was a good win there for the Panthers. And I was pretty happy to predict that one because most people were tipping the Roosters and pretty convincingly as well because they just thought that. Well, one, people don't know who Brad Schneider is. Schneider is a better player than people give credit for, right? Brad Schneider is a better player than people give credit for. And I didn't think that they would be so drastically out of action with Schneider. Similar to Tristan Saylor with the Broncos to Reece Walsh, is that I didn't think that they'd be, although Cleary is way better of a player than Brad Schneider, Schneider definitely can still get the job done with the players around him. That is still fantastic. You know, the Panthers still have some fantastic players. And they didn't even have Fisher Harris as well, so it's a big win there for the Panthers. Now, the ins here for Manly, Aaron Woods, Gordon Chankum Tong, Jake Arthur, and Raymond Toimaolo Vaega, with the outs being Nada. The fullback, Tommy Trbojevic, with the wingers being Tommy Talau and Jackson Polo, with the centers being Tong Takwala and Ruben Garrick. The 5'8 is Luke Brooks, with the halfback being Dally Cherry Evans, who is captain. You go to the front rowers, Talia Paseka and Josh Aloyer, with the 9 being Lachlan Croker. Back row, Hamoli Olukuatu and Ben Trbojevic, with the lock of Jake Trbojevic. Interchange, Carl Lawton, Corey Waddell, Tor44 Sipoli, and Nathan Brown. With the reserves being Ethan Bullimore, Jake Arthur, Aaron Woods, Raymond Tuimalolo Vaega, and Gordon Chankum Tong. I like this Manly team. I don't want to completely go off them based off of the last game against the Dragons, although it does show that they're going to be quite inconsistent this season. But I do think if Tommy Trbojevic is on, Luke Brooks is on, Cherry Evans is on, Lachlan Croker is on, this team will be better than you think. But it's just that defensively in that 2-5, I still worry. I do still worry in that 2-5 there of the defensive side of things for Manly. And their forwards are hard workers, but they don't necessarily light it up. But I'm just in a bit of two minds. I'm in a bit of two minds what to think of this Manly team at the moment. I'm a little bit confused. Now, you go to the Panthers. Their ins, Jack Cole, James Fisher-Harris, Paul Alamotti, and Tyron Peachy with no one being out. Fullback Dylan Edwards with the wingers being Suna Toruva and Brian To'o. Centers of Isaac Tungo and Taylan May with a 5'8 Jerome Luai, 7 still Brad Schneider. You go to the front row, Moses Leota and James Fisher-Harris with the number 9 being Mitch Kenny. Back row, Luke Garner and Liam Martin with the 13 being Isaiah Yeo, who is captain. Interchange, Dane Laurie, Lindsay Smith, Liam Henry and Matty Eisenhuth with the reserves being Sonny Luke, Paul Alamotti, Maverick Geyer, Jack Cole and Tyron Peachy. So nothing really changed here for the Panthers at all. They do have Fisher-Harris. Sorry, that is a big change there. And realistically, but they should win. Do I tip them though? Because whilst I was reading out Manly, I just have this urge right now to tip Manly. But I had the same urge to tip the Rabbitohs against the Roosters, and that failed badly. With this being Brookvale, it does give you a bit of hope that Manly could get up for it. But I'm going to take the Panthers. I think until the Panthers prove you wrong, you have to be reliant upon them. You know, until they prove you wrong, I don't think I can. I want to put this on record, though, that I could see Manly winning this game and surprising everyone. I could see Manly winning this game and being the shock of the weekend for sure. But I will still tip Panthers because, again, I don't think until they prove otherwise, you should go against them. So I'll take the Panthers in this game 1-12. But that's crazy. Brad Schneider was pretty good for the Raiders. It was okay. It was fine. AHG says, I think we can bounce back and cause an upset in this one up the Eagles. I can see a world. I can see a world, man. Like I said, on record, I'm just going to have a drink here. But on record, I want to say that I think Manly will definitely be up for this game and could definitely get a shock in this one. Elliot Powell says, DC will probably try to do his best to get the upset. He becomes the most cap Manly Seagull ever on Saturday. Yeah, but like, of course he's going to try to do his best to win. You know, like, what's the point of him being out there on the field? what's the point of him being out there on the field if he's not going to try his best to do to get the upset? But that is a good point. You know, that is a milestone for Manly. Maybe that's what I'm getting driven for. I still go Panthers, but I do see a world the Manly Seagulls do win this game in an upset. Aiden braces Panthers by 20. Lucas Generous said, oof, that's a big score. Lucas Generous says Panthers 36 to 12. That's crazy. Says, well, I mean, Manly did beat the Roosters and Panthers beat the Roosters with no Cleary, so you cannot write Manly off not one bit. No, I can't. I can't write Manly off. I can't write Manly off. But then again, that doesn't really make sense. Manly did beat Roosters and Panthers beat Roosters with no Cleary, so you cannot write. I don't understand how that correlates. How does Manly beating Roosters and Panthers beating Roosters with no Cleary thus mean that you can't write Manly off? I don't understand the correlation there. James Stevens says, Manly have a soft underbelly as they showed last weekend. Again, I didn't really get to watch that game too much, right? Because I was at the Titans game. But from all reports I've seen and from the highlights I've watched and whatnot, yeah, Manly just made a lot of mistakes. And I don't believe in Anthony Seibold. I think with a better coach, they would be a lot better. And I will stick by that. I will stick by that. I've stuck by that since the preseason. I'll stick by that now. So I'm going to take Panthers 1-12 in this game. But all right, I'm going to move on to the next game now. Panthers 1-12. Could see a World 30 plus. Could see a Manly win. But I'll take Panthers 1-12. Next game we have is the Dolphins taking on the West Tigers in what is a strange game to predict. Very strange game to predict. But I think I'm going to go. I think I know who I'm going to go with. Now, guys, obviously hit that like button and subscribe if you are new around here. The Dolphins come into this game as $1.59 favourites, while the Tigers are $2.36 underdogs. Dolphins are first, with the Tigers being sixth, and this is at Suncorp Stadium in Brisbane. The reason why I did this is because the bye also gives them those advantages. Tigers had the bye round one. Dolphins had the bye round three. Yeah, round three, because Titans had bye round two, Tigers round one, and Dolphins round three. So the latter is not necessarily reflective as we currently speak, but the Dolphins, obviously, their season so far. Yes, obviously they did beat the Titans on the weekend. Again, I'll say a lot of that came down to the Titans. Let's not lie to ourselves. It's just been how it goes. They got flogged by the Cowboys in week one, 43-18. They flogged the Dragons, 38-0. They had the bye, and they obviously beat the Titans here, 30-14. But if you click onto this game here, you do see the Titans, they actually led this game 10-0 at one stage. And the Dolphins are getting off to really slow starts, which is the worry for them. The worry for the Dolphins is that they're getting off to slow starts. And again, I will say that every game the Titans are in, there is so many reasons to say why it is the Titans losing those games, especially in such large periods that you can actually pinpoint individual things Titans are doing that are going away from them. And I hope that, well, I know that Desi is really working them about that. And then the West Tigers, on the other hand, they had the bye round one, got flowed by the Rays 32-12, and they've had good two wins since, 32-6 over the Sharkies at Leichhardt, and then 17-16, obviously on Easter Monday, against the Eels. And they're two decent enough teams there that give them a lot of hope, you know. So the Tigers are kind of loving life right now. Even if you lost this game, I still think you'd be loving life, because you've already got half your wins from last season in the first four rounds of the year. So you're pretty happy right now, and I think that you shouldn't be having crazy high expectations. You're not going to go undefeated for the rest of the season. You probably still don't make the eight. I don't think you make the eight. But, you know, have a bit of fun with it. You know, have a bit of fun with it and just kind of look at what you're doing. Look at what you're doing and just be excited about the moment rather than the future is what I would say. Just be excited in the moment for the time being. Now, the ins here for the Dolphins. Jared Wallace, Mason Teague, Oren Keeley, Sean O'Sullivan, Tessie New in. Max Plack is out. Should have been sent off in that game. Hamisa Tapuafoto was the fullback. I'll stand by that too. Max Plus should have been sent off. Hamisa Tapuafoto was the fullback with Jermaine Asako and Jack Bostock as the wingers, with Jake Averillo and Herbie Farnworth as the centers. You got the 5'8 of Cody Nikorima and the halfback of Isaiah Katoa. Front row, Jesse Bromwich was captain alongside Thomas Flegler and Jeremy Marshall King as the nine. You go to the back row, Felix Kafusi and Ewan Aiken, with the lock being Ray Stone. Interchange wise, Josh Kerr, Cote Donahue, Mark Nichols, and Kenneth Bromwich, with the reserves being Oren Keeley, Sean O'Sullivan, Jared Wallace, Tessie New, and Mason Teague. This Dolphins team is pretty much what you would expect, man, besides Max Plath not being at 13, but Ray Stone's kind of been in and out for them for the last year, you know, when they've been in the competition. They've only been around the competition for a year and a bit now. So Ray Stone is not, you know, an outsider of this position. And yeah, I think the Dolphins are fine. You know, I think the people are kind of going to overrate them now because of their positioning on the ladder. But you'll see what I mean. Like, you'll see what I mean eventually. I don't think you'll see it in this game, though. I think you'll see a pretty good game out of the Dolphins in this one, you would expect. Now for the Tigers, the ins, Alex Tuil, Brent Naden, Jake Simkin, Latu Fainu, and Solomon Alamailo, with the out being Lachlan Galvin due to suspension. Fullback, Dream Buller, the Dream Buller. Charlie stands on the wings with Junior Tupou and Solomon Fatape and Justin Olam in the centres. He's been so good this year. Olam has the 5'8". Jaden Sullivan comes in with Aiden Caesar as the halfback. Front rowers of Stefano Utuakamanu and David Clemmer, with the number 9 being Apisai Godoy-Sau, who is captain. Back row is Isaiah Papali'i and John Bateman, with the 13 being Fanua Pole. You go to the interchange, Latu Fainu, Alex Saifarth, Alex Tuil, and Samuela Fainu. With the reserves being Brent Naden, Asim Kipoa, Justin Matamua, Solomon Alamalo, and Jake Simpkin. The Tigers obviously really disappointed to lose Lachlan, Lachlan Galvin, who was a 5'8". He was really good in the weekend, actually got him the win against the Parramatta Squeals. For a rookie, it was also binned in that game, which is why he suspended, but came back and absolutely crushed it. I do think they lose a lot without him. And that's a big thing to say for a rookie. And I do think there is a world, and they probably would have lost this game even with Lachlan Galvin, to be completely honest with you, because the Tigers are not going to be consistently winning throughout the season. They're not going to be consistent with it, even though they've won two games here, which is great. But I have got the Dolphins here, and I will say the Dolphins 13+. And I know Tigers fans are going to hate me for it, but I do think the Dolphins up there in Brisbane at Suncorp Stadium, I just feel like they're going to be too fast and they're going to have a little bit more defined play through Nikarima and Isaiah Katoa. I don't think Sullivan is as good as I thought he was going to be there for the Tigers. But I do think that Apisai Godoy-Sau will give a good old crack there for the Tigers. But there is a... And the thing that is positive for me in regards to the Tigers this year is they showed resilience in that game, that they could have easily just thrown it all away when they started going behind by 10 points with like 15 minutes to go or whatever. The Tigers could have thrown that away with 20 minutes to go, and then with the bend, they only got 2 points to the Eels. The old Tigers would have lost that game by 30+, but this Tigers found a way to win. So I am really impressed by that, but I just think that Lachlan Galvin has been such a key instrumental part of this Tigers team that they do lose a lot without him. So I'd love to be proven wrong. Love to see the Tigers get up here, went through on the trot. I will say the Dolphins confidently, though. I will say the Dolphins confidently. And that's not me saying the Dolphins make the 8. I do not believe the Dolphins are even close to a top 8 team. I will throw this out there. I do not believe that. I think there are much better teams than the Dolphins. But I do think their run of games right now, like, let's go have a look at their draw. Let's go have a look at the draw. And you tell me who they've played. You tell me who they've played to prove that they are the team that you guys think. They've played the Cowboys and lost 43-18. Cowboys aren't the proven product yet either. They've had a soft draw, but they got flogged. They beat the Dragons. They got the Titans, and they got the Tigers. Next week, the Broncos and the Eels are two games that they'll look towards, even though the Eels are still kind of struggling at the moment as well. You know, but look at their draw. You can't tell me the NRL haven't given them a soft draw here. You cannot tell me. You know, the Cowboys didn't finish in the 8 last year. Dragons, bottom 4. Titans, bottom 4. Tigers, the last 2 years. Broncos, great. Eels, outside of the 8. Knights, everyone knows the Knights. They've been given a soft draw to start the season. And I'm just saying, this Dolphins team, you'll see what I'm talking about a little bit later on. But I do think they win this game, and I think they'll win this game well. I will say 13+ in this one. I will say 13+. Sam Jenkins says Tigers by 12. Desmond says Tigers the Premiership. Good luck. Aiden Bray says Dolphins by 6. Aguero says Tigers at 20, Phoenix 21. Yeah, actually, exactly right, Sam. You feeling all right, Daz? You want me to call you an ambulance? Daz? I thought you thought the Doggers would win the Premiership, mate. The dog will win the Premiership. The woof woof, no woof woof. No woof woof. No woof woof. Come on, man. Daz, mate. Gee whiz, man. I thought better of you. You're always doggy doggy woof woof. No more doggy woof woof. Gee whiz, Daz. You used to be cool, man. Gage Nucleus Sun says, I'm a back of my team Dolphins 1-12. I think it's going to be a close game, but also a very good game. I don't know. I think Dolphins win this one relatively confidently. Joshua's Adventures says, Dolphins are going to tear up that left edge of the Tigers. Probably. Sam says, I loved Clemmer during Gubbo's kick and feeding him after. Yeah, that was good. Stathamus says, Sarkis, and of course, the Titans are winning the comp. Exactly right, does. Exactly right. Brendan Kipalan says Dolphins 9+ first half, and Bizzalad says Tigers by 16. You're dreaming. All right, let's move now into the Sunday games. Oh, I look forward to talking about this one. Yes. Woo. We're excited, folks. We're excited to talk about this one. Oh, yeah. Oh, yes. Can't wait. Guys, obviously hit that thumbs up button. Subscribe if you're new around here. Sunday, 4 o'clock. North Queensland Cowboys take on the Gold Coast Titans up there in North Queensland at Queensland Country Bank Stadium. I will be there. As you guys know, I will be there. The Cowboys coming in third. The Titans coming in first. Just to add a 7 on the end of that. It turns into 17th, but there's still a 1 involved. Not many other teams can say, there's still, oh wait, no, there can be 10, 11, 12, just ignore me. Hey, listen, better than the top 8, except for the first place, so mind games, there you go. Cowboys are $1.14 favourites, whilst the Titans are $5.75 underdogs. Cowboys obviously coming to this game. After getting whooped by the Broncos, it was not a good game there by the Cows. I did tip the Bronx to win that game. I got called a Cowboys hater, even though I don't mind the Cowboys. I actually like the Cowboys, to be fair. And then the Broncos whooped him, which I predicted. The Cowboys obviously beat the Dolphins 43-18. Awful against the Knights, 21-20, but they won, which was good for them up there in North Queensland. And then, they've only played one game up there at home so far. And then, obviously, yeah, beat the Dragons 46-24 at Netstride Jubilee in Cogra. And then, obviously, lost the Broncos in a big game for them, 38-12 in Suncorp, which is a game that is still kind of a home game for the Cows. It's not, like, a crazy difference, right? The Cowboys have been up and down, I would say. Even though their form is 3-1, I would still say that they're up and down because this was not a great performance. At 21-20 against the Knights was not a great performance. This was a slow start. This was a very, very slow start. And this was just domination from the start. And this was just awful, right? So the Cowboys, I don't know how to gather them yet. I'm really trying to get that lasso and try to figure it out. Trying to figure out where to get them. I don't know. I don't know what the Cowboys are right now. So, yeah, I'm going to say the Cowboys are still a very up and down team, despite the fact that they are 3-1. But you know who's not an up and down team? It's this team. I tell you who's not an up and down team. It is this team. They are just down right now, man. We obviously lost in the first round 28-4. Had the bye. Hey, got 2 points. And then lost the Bulldogs 32-0 and lost the Dolphins 30-14 despite leading that game 10-0. Now, the positive that I find out of that is that the Titans started off strong and fell apart. And the Cowboys are slow starters. But come home strong normally, not the Broncos game in the rain. It's actually meant to be wet up there in North Queensland, I believe I saw. Sam, can you confirm that for me, please? I think it's going to be wet, which might be a good little thing for the Titans, maybe, because we saw what happened in the wet at Suncorp for the Broncos against the Cows. But yeah, look, I'm disappointed. I'm not going to lie to you guys. You know, I do what I can, but this team is not finding it right now. But it's too early. I've got to think like that, you know. And I saw comments on TBC the other week saying, oh, Blaze or Big KO comes and says that it's only early, I'm going to flip it. I don't give a shit what you think. I'm not going to lie to you because it is still early. That doesn't mean that I just give up on the season. Now I can't mentally do that. But at the end of the day, I'm also realistic to say that this is one of the hardest seasons that I've ever had to put up with. And I've put up with 2011. I've put up with 2019. I've put up with 2022. You know, so those seasons were really hard. But this right now is on the trajectory to be worse. So I'm very realistic about what's happening right now, but I also will tell you that it's only early. And you know what? Desi Hasler, they were 0-4 with Manly in 2021, made the prelim, and in 2009, they were also 0-4 at Manly under Desi, and they made the prelim. So I just got to hold out hope, mate. I just got to hold out belief in this team, and I do still back in this team. I just think that we just need to find something that clicks, and once it clicks, man, bing, bong, bing. Thanks for coming. But all right, the Cowboys ins, Jake Clifford, Mali Bitungane, Semi Valame, and Tom Chester, with the outs being Nada. Fullback, Scotty Drinkwater, with the wingers being Kyle Felt and Murray Tolangi, with Val Holmes and Zach Labor in the centres. We've got the 5'8 of Tommy Dearden, who is captain, and Chad Townsend, who is halfback. You go to the front rowers of Jordan McLean and Jason Tamalolo, with Reece Robson as the hooker. Back rowers of Jeremiah Nene and Kulikefu Finifiuiaki with Ruben Cotter as the lock. Interchange-wise, Jake Granville, Griffin Neem, Sammy McIntyre, and Jack Kosiewski. Tom Chester, Thomas McKayley, Semi Valame, Marley Bitungane, and Jake Clifford are the reserves. Cowboys team is pretty much what you would expect, man. It's a full-strength back 1 through 7, and I'm pretty certain that's a full-strength 8 through 13 minus the long-term injury of Harlan Lukey. But it's pretty much a full-strength team. Looking forward to seeing Sammy McIntyre, who actually re-signed with the club. Obviously, I know Sammy well. He's a good bloke. This Cowboys team should be expected to win this game. They should be expected to win this game. They've got no excuses. Their fans will riot if they lose this game. For the Titans, on the other side, Isaac Fasu-Malawi, Jacob Alec Wienke. Is that you? Is Alec Wienke new. Jake Balick is what I know him as. It must be new. Jojo Fafita, Josiah Pahulu, Tom Weaver, and Tony Francis, with the outs being Isaac Liu and Philip Sami, who was injured for 3 weeks. Max Plus should have been sent off. You go to the fullback, Jaden Campbell, with the wingers being Harley Smith-Shields and Jojo Fafita. They're the two ones that come in for Sami and also for Loffy, who did get dropped. The Loffy Meister did get dropped. Now, I'm going to clarify something for everyone here, especially for Titans fans. Olofiana has a lot of work to do defensively. He was one of the biggest attacking weapons that we have. He is such a speedster. He is such a great player on attack. But if you watched my vlog, you know that I lost my shit at one of his defensive plays on the weekend. And I love Lof. And I'll back Lof in. But he does need to have it. He had this wake-up call last year too. He got dropped, came back, and then ended up scoring a bunch of tries. But he did get dropped early in the season last year as well. And now he's been dropped again. And hopefully it's a wake-up call. And he comes back bigger than ever. Right? But I do agree with the decision. But I do think that he will be back sooner rather than later. So Harley Smith-Shields and Jojo Fafita on the wings, with Brian Kelly and AJ Brimson in the centres. You go to the 5'8", Kieran Foran, who is captain, and Tanner Boyd as the halfback. You go to the front row, Moeki Fodawaker and Jimmy Jolliffe, with the number 9 being Chris Randall. You got Cleese Haas and Bo Firmer as the starting back row, and Aaron Clark as the lock. Interchange-wise, Sam Verrills, Dave Fafita, Joe Stimson, and Josiah Pahulu get a debut. Love him to see him. Josiah Pahulu is a monster. He's been killing it for the Ipswich Jets this season. I do think that Dave, actually we'll get into it in a second, reserves Isaac Fasumalawi, Tony Francis, Tom Weaver, Alofiana Kamperera, and Jacob Alec Wienke is the reserves. What I'll say is I think Dave Fafita could definitely start. I personally think right this very second that Cleese is actually one of our best players this so far this season. Maybe not attacking-wise, but defensively for sure. I would have Dave and Cleese next to each other. I would have Dave and Cleese as the starting back rowers, which might be a bit of a bold call. I want Bowie in the team, but I do think that Dave should be starting alongside Cleese. I think Cleese has earned it right now. I think that Bowie hasn't come back in as great as we were expecting, but we do know that he has greatness in him. We do know that he can be very good. So, but I do think that right now Cleese has earned that spot in that back row, to be completely honest with you. But we just gotta back ourselves in there. We just have to go up there with the mentality of being able to do what we did to the Cowboys last year. The Cowboys were expected to make the 8. They were winning games on the trot. I think it was 7 games in a row or something like that. And they lost. The Cowboys lost to us at Seabus Super Stadium. Now, granted, this is at Queensland Country Bank Stadium, but I believe in us. So I will tell you guys right now that if you are just for everybody here, when I do my tips for Titans games, I always tell you, I will tip the Titans, but take what I say, have your own thoughts, take what the internet says, even though half of those people are clowns, and then put all three together and then just come with an understanding of what I've said, what you think, what other people say, and then make a decision, because I am going to back my team in always. I'm not going to go into a game expecting a loss. I do think that this one, if you're looking from a realistic perspective, there's a reason why we're $5.75 underdogs. There's a massive reason. Right, but I will say, the negatives of the Cowboys, they're still not the finished product yet at all. We did beat them the last time we played them, which was when they were massively in form, and we're desperate right now. We're desperate. So that's what I'll say about the Titans there, man. You can disagree with me all you like, and I can see why you disagree with me, but I will be backing my team as we travel up to Townsville. Sam Jenkins says, this will be the wake-up game. Titans 1-12. James Simmons, Cowboys 30+, 13+, Aiden Brace, Cowboys 30. Oh, you're a hero, mate. Blah, 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 you're a real hero, Aiden. Blah, 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 says Titans derailed the Cowboys' late season surge last year, so I wouldn't be surprised if Peyton has the boys fired up for this to bounce back. Or you could think on the other perspective as well. Lucas Shannon says Cowboys 36-12, hero. Reece 77, Cowboys 42-16, you're a hero. Brendan Kipperland says Titans are seriously lagging, Cowboys 13+. I can't wait for us to... Like, if we find a way, like, you guys will get torn. If we find a way, because there is such absolute negativity here, like, just to throw that out there, like, we did beat them last year, for God's sake. Like, for God's sake. Like, look at all these Cowboys 13+ clowns, man. Like, truly, 30+. Like, I'll listen to the 13, but, like, the 30+ clowns here, man. Like, get a grip. Get a grip of yourselves. I'm not asking you to tip the Titans, but, like, come on, man. 30+, get a grip of yourself, man. Gee whiz. Lucas says, Cows stuck in the rain. They have only won 1 out of 10 in the rain. So, yeah, we're struggling in the rain. James Stevens says, yeah, Zach Laybutt is bang average. I disagree. I think Zach Lavett's a good player. I think that the last couple of games haven't been his best, but I think he can be a good player. I just think that the last couple of games hasn't exactly been at their best, and obviously it was in the rain against the Bronx, man. In the rain, it was against the Bronx. Wow, it's pouring down rain in the Gold Coast right now. I don't know. I've got to have high thoughts, man. I've got to keep believing my team. But yeah, people, real heroes going 30 plus, and some clown up there saying 50 plus. Gross, Titans 14, Cowboys 12. I don't think if you're not a Titans fan, you would believe that we win this game. But I'll still hold hope for this team, to be fair. I like it. Is it lock, Sam Jenkins says? Hopefully, man. And we'll be seeing you, bro. Absolutely. All right, so let's go into the final game, you guys. I back my team. Fortunately, Aiden, read the room, dude. Read the room, dude. All right, so let's move into the last game here. Let's move into the last game, which is the Canberra Raiders versus the Parramatta Eels Squeals. Obviously, hit that thumbs up button and subscribe if you are new around here. Raiders come into this game in 8th position, whilst the Eels come into this game in 9th position. Geo Stadium in Canberra, and the Raiders are $1.80, while the Eels are $2.05. Surprised the Raiders are actually favourites for this game, but then again, I guess that's because Mitchell Moses isn't playing. If Moses was playing, they probably would be the favourites, to be completely honest with you. The Raiders, they come into this game, not a great deal of excitement, to be fair. I won't get rid of you, Aiden, but I have seen a lot of hate and negativity on my channel from you for a while now, to be fair. I have. Jay, if you believe that we should hide him, just do it, to be completely honest with you, man. I don't really care. I have seen every comment from him over the last few weeks and months and whatnot being negative, so if you want to get rid of him, you can. But let's go into the Raiders here. The Raiders in regards to their game so far this season. The Raiders beat the Knights 28-12 up there at McDonald's Jones Stadium. That was probably one of their best games of the season. They beat the Tigers 32-12. Wasn't exactly the most fantastic game there. Wasn't exactly the most fantastic. I would still say the Knights was their best clinical performance of the season. 18-10 was a loss to the Warriors in New Zealand, which was, you know, it was a grindy effort, but the Warriors did outgrind them. They did outgrind them, and then obviously you've got the Sharkies game where they led 18-0 and then fell apart and lost 36-22, which was really disappointing there for the Raiders. But now they are back at home in Canberra. You do obviously like to see that. And they will have actually lost in Canberra so far this season. Beat Tigers. They've only played there once. So that is a big benefit. 32-12. They have a couple of home games because they play us next week as well. I think the Raiders will be chirping being back home. Obviously, for the Parramatta of the Squeals, they beat the Doggies 26-8. Wasn't fantastic, but did the job. Lost the Panthers 26-18. Beat Manly controversially 28-24, but still beat them, scored 28 points, and then lost the Tigers 17-16. So, not been a great season for them, to be completely honest with you, because this one was controversial. This one was good enough. You know, you take it. This wasn't great at all, and this one they threw away when they had the win, pretty much. When they had a man-up advantage with, like, 20 minutes to go, they had the advantage, man, and they just lost it. They just completely lost their way. So, and that was to the Tigers. So they come against a Raiders team that knows how to grind out a result, man. They know how to grind out a result. I think that this one for the Eels here, they have to really turn up because this will not be an easy game for them at all. Now, the ins here for the Raiders, Emre Gouldah, KO Weeks, Simi Sasungi, Trey Mooney, and Zach Wolford, with the out being Zach Hosking, unfortunately. You go to the fullback, Jordan Rapana, with the wingers being James Schiller and Xavier Savage, centers of Matty Tomoko and Sebastian Chris. You got the 5'8", Ethan Strange. You got the halfback of Jamal Fogarty, with the front rowers of Josh Papali'i and Joseph Tarpany, who was captain. Danny Levi is the hooker. He's been great this season for me in regards to the Raiders, Danny Levi. You got the back row, Hazen Young and Atamariota, with the 13 being Morgan Smithies. Interchange-wise, Tom Starling, Corey Horsbrough, Simi Sasangi, and Pasami Saulo, with the reserves being KO Weeks, Nick Kotrich, Trey Mooney, Zach Wolford, and Emre Gouldah. So this Raiders team, what you'd expect minus Zach Hosking. Obviously, they're also missing Elliot Whitehead. So Atamariota goes from their starting back row. Surprised Horsbrough's not starting, to be fair. But Smithies has been so good in regards to that lock position tackling-wise. He can't get in. They've got two great front rowers. So I guess if you think Horsbrough's a back rower, he would have gone in for Hosking. But he's not really a back rower. So Horsbrough off the bench is such a great bit of depth talent there that you can bring off the bench. Because he is a Queensland player. He could play. He's a Queensland player. So Origin caliber. So that is amazing there forwards wise for the Raiders. And the back line's actually not been that bad this season, man. James Schiller, not that great, but overall, I don't think that 1-7 is as bad as we thought it was going into the season. So really pleasantly surprised by that. Now the ins here for the Eels: Dejan Arce, Makaesi Makatoa, Ofahiki Ogden, and Owerimu Grigg are the ins with no outs. Fullback wise, Clint Gallison is the captain with Mike Arcivo, Tosoviti, and Sean Russell on the wings. Bailey Simonson and Will Penasini as the centres. You got the 5'8", Blaise Talangi, who had a fantastic game, in my personal opinion, against the Tigers. And then the halfback is Dylan Brown. Issue with the halves, though, is that they play the same way. Front rowers, Regan Campbell-Gillard and Junior Bolo, with Joey Lasick as the hooker. Go to the back row, Sean Lane and Ryan Madison, with the 13 being Jermaine Hopgood. Interchange-wise, Luke Moretti, Will McGregor, Joe Offa-Hengawi, and Campbell Talangi, with the reserves being Offa-Hiki Ogden, Dejan Arce, Brendan Hands, Makahesi Makatoa, and Morgan Harper. For the Eels, again, this concerns me. They're both, Blaise Talangi and Dylan Brown are both run-first players rather than definitive players. Dylan Brown has to be the definitive one, especially when he's the halfback, but he's not. That's just not how he plays. And Blaise Talangi is, you know, young, and Dylan Brown needs to lead, to be fair. The 1-5 needed better. Gutho has actually been, defensively, the worst player this season, FYI. FYI, I saw a stat. Gutho is the worst defensive player for the fullback position across all 17 clubs this season. I think he's made 10 tackles, missed 18 or something like that. Or missed 8 or something like that. So he's made 10 out of 18. I think that was the stat. I could be wrong. Correct me if I'm wrong. But Gutho hasn't really had to... has missed quite a few tackles this year, which is what is usually a bit of his bread and butter, actually, to be fair. So hopefully we see him get back to that this time around. The forward battle is actually really, really nice between the Raiders and the Eels. The Eels have a good forward pack. The Raiders have a good forward pack, obviously missing out on their center back rower. But the forward packs are going to be a great battle. The hookers are even, in my opinion. Dan Levo probably edges it. The front rowers are definitely even. The back rowers, you lean probably towards the Eels. And then the 13s, I probably lean towards... Well, they're two different 13s. Hopgood's different to Smithies. I would lean with Hopgood, though, personally. And then interchange-wise, I lean with the Raiders there. 1-7. Fun fact for you. I'd lean with the Raiders, which I wouldn't say much. I would not say much. So, with that being said, I don't know why it's clicked off there. I am going to... I can't believe it's their favourites. I will take... Who do I take in this game? This is a tough game to predict. This might be the toughest game of the weekend. I'm going to take the Eels. I think they might have a bit more flair. I think the Raiders, if they bring it into a grind, they win. If the Raiders bring this game into a real nitty-gritty grind, they win this game. But I think the Eels will have a bit of flair about them, and I think they'll learn from their mistakes against the... I think they'll learn from their mistakes against the Tigers. I'm going to take the Eels 1-12. It's a bold call. Gunner says, Brad Arthur told the Eels at halftime to play defensive, which confused me as one, our defense is horrible, and two, we had most field possession in the first half. Agreed. Also, take the two. You take any of those three twos and you win the game. James Stephen getting around Tarpany. Bizzalad, Eels by one. Sam says, pretty sure he said to take it back to simple footy. At least that's what the commentary said. Brandon Kipalan says, this game could go either way. My money's on the Raiders 1-12. This game is either way, bro. It really is. I'm going to take the Eels 1-12, but this game is either way. There's just something urging me to take the Raiders here, but I just feel like maybe I'm just getting too much drawn into the flair of what Blaise Lung and Dylan Brown can do. Maybe. I don't know. I'm going to back in what I've said. I'm going to back in what I'm thinking. I'm going to take the Eels 1-12, yeah. I'm going to take the Eels 1-12. Gunner says, you're probably right. I'm just going off what I was told and heard. Well, there you go, guys. There's my predictions for this week. So let's go through the predictions that we've gone with. We went with the Storm in Melbourne. We went with the Roosters. We did go with the Knights. We went with the Warriors. Oh, we've got every favourite. That's not going to happen. I've gone with the Panthers, the Dolphins, except for obviously this one, but we all know the reasoning behind that one. We've gone with the Titans, and we've also gone with the... Actually, no, the Eels are not favourites. Okay, I'll take that. The Eels are not favourites, so... Yeah, yeah. Parrot don't have a good record in Canberra too. Lachlan, you're right. They don't have a good record in Canberra. But then again, records made to be broken, man. They are made to be broken. So I'll take the Eels. But Sharkies obviously have the bye this week, which they'll be loving after a comeback win there against the Raiders. But there we go, guys. I'm going to jump off because I've got to film the Gold Coast Titans Frontline podcast with Clarkie in 10 minutes' time. So we did this in great time. I hope you have enjoyed. Obviously, hit that thumbs up button. Subscribe if you're new around here. I appreciate you guys for tuning in. I'll see you tomorrow for the Storm versus the Broncos game. We'll be live streaming every game this weekend. On the Sunday, you're going to have Raiders, Eels, Wobble and Jaw Sports. We'll be covering for you. And I'm trying to see if I can get someone for Cowboys Titans. He did ask us to do Cowboys Titans, but I said I'm not going to get a Cowboys fan on for Cowboys Titans, obviously. But he'll be doing Raiders versus the Eels, and we're going to try and find someone for Cowboys Titans. If not, then at least you'll get Raiders versus the Eels, and you can have a chat with him about the Cowboys Titans game anyway. But yeah, hope you enjoyed, and I will see you guys tomorrow. Alright, guys, thanks for watching. Catch you later. See ya.